Ellie, first on possible witness tampering, the more we are learning about it, the worse it sounds. I mean, how much trouble could this now mean for the people around Donald Trump and Donald Trump himself if they were trying to influence Cassidy Hutchinson's testimony?
Okay, I've done obstruction of justice and witness tampering cases. I've certainly done my share of them. And often the communications that you're looking at are vague or ambiguous, and you sort of have to read between the lines. That is not the case here. The strongest line in what we've seen is, you have to protect who you need to protect. That is about as straightforward as it gets when it comes to witness tampering. Now, the committee, it sounds like, according to Manu's reporting, they've been asking everybody, has this been communicated to you? They need to get their arms around how many people have heard this kind of threat, and they need to enlist the United States Department of Justice, as Liz Cheney suggested, because the committee, frankly, is defenseless here. They can't bring obstruction charges. Only DOJ can. DOJ needs to do that. They need to get on that to protect the committee's investigation, to protect DOJ's own investigation, which apparently is ongoing, and to send a message to people around Donald Trump. This is not tolerated. There will be real consequences. Only DOJ can impose those consequences.
Yeah. Alyssa, you're close with Cassidy Hutchinson. I mean, you said today that you helped her when she had reached out about wanting to say more to the committee, and also in doing so needing a new attorney to kind of move forward, as we've now seen as it play out. So based on what you know, are you surprised to hear that she was one of the people on the receiving end of these messages?
I wasn't surprised. In fact, I kind of expected when Congresswoman Cheney read through those that at least one of them had gone to Cassidy. When we spoke, and I don't want to betray her confidence, but the sense that I got was somebody who didn't feel empowered to share what they knew in their knowledge, and there was a level of intimidation there. And one thing I want to note, Ellie's the lawyer, and I think he laid out beautifully what the actual issue as far as witness tampering is, but Cassidy Hutchinson is now facing a smear campaign, and what is really, the Trump world is trying to make an example of her right now in the public eye to try to scare other witnesses out of coming forward. Some of what's been pushed about her, and luckily credible sources aren't publishing a lot of it, but she is coming under an onslaught from Trump world, and that's just another way, this sort of thuggish way in which they try to keep people from telling the truth.
I think that's a really important point. It's not just efforts leading up to, it's during and after, as you're laying out now. It's ongoing still, no matter who it is, where it's coming from. It's coming with the motivation of exactly what you're saying, a smear campaign. Gloria, members of the committee have suggested, as Monty was laying out, that there is more evidence of possible witness intimidation. Mm-hmm. What's your gut tell you on where this goes? Because the committee is so much it's focusing on as well, not just, obviously, questions and concerns of witness intimidation.
Well, I think it goes to the Justice Department. And I think that what they have to do with the committee is figure out who is doing the witness tampering here. Where did these calls and come from, or emails come from, and to whom? And was it the same person? And did they do it at the behest of someone like Donald Trump, for example, or did they do it on their own, and did they do it multiple times? I mean, I think that, this is something that clearly needs to be investigated. And if they've asked these questions to every witness, then they can collate all this information. And I think Liz Cheney is right. I mean, this is not for the Congress to decide, but I think they can hand this over either as a referral or just hand over the information to the Justice Department and let the Justice Department investigate.
Yeah, Alyssa, I do want to ask you, because you're talking about the smear campaign, and Donald Trump himself is not just in statements, but he is now out there responding to Cassidy's testimony, and unsurprisingly at all, he's attacking her personally, trying to attack her credibility. I want to play just some of what he said, and I say this with the caveat of, I want to play this not to have it out there, but because this is what those who may speak to the committee, this is what they are seeing. This is what they have to consider, because this is what Trump is putting out there in terms of attacking these people. Listen.
This lady yesterday, there's something wrong with her. The woman is living in fantasy land. Some whack job. She's got serious problems. Let me put it that way.
What did you make of Fox
Mental
News?
Problems.
I mean, what do you say to that, Alyssa?
Well, it's classic Trump playbook. He, after I've spoken out against him, he's put out two statements against me using very similar language, calling me a clown, a loser, a nobody says he doesn't know
You're
me.
You're absolutely right. Almost absolutely the same language. I now remember that. It's striking.
Exactly.
I didn't think of that until now.
Exactly. And it's actually quite lazy. And listen, I've been in Air Force One's the presidential cabin with Cassidy Hutchinson and Donald Trump. So it's like this is just it's an absurdity. But it does. I do think how aggressive he's been in responding to this hearing in particular shows what a nerve her testimony struck. He put out a number of posts on his Truth Social, I think half a dozen, the most he has after any hearing after Cassidy's testimony. And then his aides made the decision to put him on Newsmax to talk about this. I've also seen sort of a full force pushback from some of the MAGA world loyalists, putting them on the airwaves of other networks, pushing back on social media. I think that he really feels the pain of this. I think he's realizing this is impacting people.
You know, Gloria, can I also ask you, I want to play something just to bring this all together, if you will. Mm-hmm. I want to play something that Liz Cheney said during her speech at the Reagan Library. Listen to this.
At this moment, we are confronting a domestic threat that we have never faced before. And that is a former president who is attempting to unravel the foundations of our constitutional republic. As we think about the choice in front of us, we have to choose because Republicans cannot both be loyal to Donald Trump and loyal to the Constitution. At this moment,
quite an interesting speech to give to a Republican audience in 2022, right, Gloria?
And to be met with a round of applause. I mean, let's just set the scene here because it's truly remarkable. Here she is, Liz Cheney, daughter of a former vice president, speaking at the Reagan Library, saying that the former president, who, by the way, is right now probably the front runner for the Republican nomination in 2024, calling him a domestic threat and saying that he is a threat to democracy, and she gets applauded by Republicans.
The choice is the Constitution or following Trump.
That's right.
It's not more. It doesn't get more stark than that. Ellie, nope. Really quick before we go, I do want to ask you about Pat Cipollone because he's now even more squarely in the spotlight now. CNN learned that he may agree to a limited transcribed interview with the January 6th committee. He's received a subpoena, as we now know. If he can't talk about privileged conversations that he had with the president as White House counsel, which is understandable, how much of a difference do you think this can still make?
Yeah, Kate, in an ideal world with unlimited time and resources, you would go to court if you were the committee and try to force him to talk about everything. I don't think he has a valid executive privilege claim. That said, they're under the gun here, and I think they've made the calculation that getting something is better than nothing. So even if they can't ask him about the most important thing, his conversations with Trump, he still had plenty of important conversations with other White House staffers. We know about some of them from Cassidy Hutchinson. I would want to know what he discussed with Mark Meadows and with other key players so they can still get something really valuable out of him.
Interesting. It's good to see you all. Thank you so much.